That's a huge part of what makes us human. You know, if everything was fabulous every day, it would be really kind of sad and boring. It's these difficulties that allow us to, you know, in the words of Clarissa Pinkola Estes, be part of the scar clan. You know, and these scarrings leave us to be more beautiful on the inside and outside.
Welcome to Season 3 of the Amani Experience Podcast. In this podcast, you will experience wisdom, advice, and stories from creatives all over the world. Your host is the award-winning Amani Roberts, who is a DJ, music producer, professor, author, and undercover gamer. On the show, we love to share the stories of creative professionals, especially people who have gone from the corporate life to the creative life. Once again, welcome to the Amani Experience Podcast.
Welcome to episode 132 of the Amani Experience Podcast. For this show, we have Kimberli Hudson with us. Kimberli is a serial entrepreneur. Three of my favorite things about this episode, number one, is Kimberly's view on perfection. It was very profound, and it really resonated with me. I think you'll respect it as well. Second, she has some fun and funny hidden self-care options, so keep an ear out for that through the interview. And then as we learn in the interview, Kimberli has been through a lot, but she is still willing to love, which gives me hope, and I'm just appreciative that she shared her experiences with us. To reach me, email me, podcast@AmaniExperience.com. Follow us on all the socials at Amani Experience. And feel free to donate to our Patreon, which is patreon.com/AmaniExperience. This episode is sponsored by my book, DJs Mean Business. You can text the letters, words, DJ AMRO, DJ AMRO, to 33777. And you'll get added to the list of people that get some free and cool upgrades when you buy the book. All right, it's time for the show. Thank you very much for listening, and to the show we go. I would like to welcome Kimberli Hudson to the Amani Experience Podcast.
Hi, how are you today, Amani?
I am doing well. How are you?
I'm fantastic. It's a beautiful day and couldn't be better.
Yes, we are here at our mobile location in Manhattan Beach, California. Tell the listeners, where did you grow up?
Oh, that's a difficult question. I actually grew up all over the world, but mostly in Alaska.
Oh, what part of Alaska?
Outside of Anchorage, up in the mountains outside of Anchorage.
So outside of Anchorage, and then I understand that you graduated from high school in Texas.
Yes, Plano, Texas.
All right, so
outside of Dallas.
So Plano, Texas. How did you find your way from Alaska to Texas?
Well, again, I grew up all over the world. My dad was in the oil industry growing up, and then when I was about 10 or 11, he started his own land development company in Alaska, and unfortunately, back in the 80s, oil went bust,
yeah.
And we lost everything. So we had family in Texas, and we moved to Texas.
Once you graduate, well, first, let's go back. I understand when you were 11 or 12, you started one of your first businesses, window washing, correct?
Actually, 17.
Okay.
I started working for my dad when I was when he started his company when I was 10 or 11.
What was the business you started when you were 17?
It was a window washing
yes.
company because my cousin owned a window washing company in Austin, and so I could go and learn from him for a couple of weeks. I graduated high school young at 17, and I tried college for a semester, and it wasn't right for me. So while I was still in college, I started a window washing company because I knew I didn't want to work for anybody else.
How did you know so early on that you didn't want to work for anyone else?
Like I said, my dad had started his own company when I was 10 or 11, land development and construction. And so he would teach me about books and customer service and how to run a business. I don't even think he knew what seeds he was planting. in the summers, I would frame houses, and I learned all of these skills at a very young age. And in high school, I had jobs, worked, for big companies and whatnot. And I thought they were kind of stupid. when you have to adhere to decisions somebody else makes that you know are incorrect decisions for the forward growth of a company, even if it's not your company, that's really difficult when you know something different.
True, true. Then once you finished high school, what happened next?
Well, like I said, I went to, I tried a semester of college and knew it wasn't the right time. And back then, you didn't go take a gap year in Europe. If I'd done that, it probably would have been a whole different ball game. But my dad told me, you either go to college now or I'm not paying for it. And I was like, well, I guess I'm starting my own company and one day I'll decide to go back. And I did. In my late 20s, I went back.
Okay. So you went out on your own, and how many companies have you created or owned so far as of right now?
13. I'm on my 13th.
Wow. How has that happened?
Well, one of the things that I like most about myself is my curiosity. I'm a learner. I'm a lifelong learner. And if there's something that interests me, I'm going to research it. And if I start going down that rabbit hole and I look at the lay of the land of business and I see there's a way to start a company and get paid while I learn more about it, I'm going to do it. And they haven't all worked, but I've learned a lot from each and every one.
What, if you were to summarize maybe two or three of the most valuable lessons you've learned from starting and owning 13 companies, what comes to mind?
Fail. Fail often, fail quickly, and know when it's time to lay that down and say, okay, this is done now. Hmm. And be okay with that. The only time that I haven't done that was the most painful time in being an entrepreneur for me.
Now, where you are today, 2020, how would you summarize yourself in 30 seconds or less?
I'm a serial entrepreneur that's owned 13 companies, and currently I have the deep honor to work with entrepreneurial women all over the world surrounding their businesses, leadership skills, and finance.
Interesting. And kind of as a nice segue, when you're working with, we'll say, creative professionals in general, such as yourself and myself, what's important for us to succeed in today's business environment?
Trust your intuition. And trust that creativity. Show up with your full self and trust that it doesn't matter what MBA programs tell you. It doesn't matter what management books tell you. What matters is what you know to be true, because that is what your customers, and of whatever type they are, whether they're buying a service or a product, that's what your customers want from you. They want you. They don't want something out of a book. So stay true to yourself.
Why do you feel it's hard for people to trust their intuition?
Because we're taught not to, right? I saw this meme the other day that was really beautiful, that when we're kids, we're given a box of crayons and we're told to create with them. And then we reach somewhere around puberty and we're given a bunch of books and formulas and told to stop creating. Hopefully, at some point in time when we get to be adults, we pick the crayons back up.
Let's hope. Very true, very true. As you look at your career, when do you feel was the turning point? This is an interesting question for you because you might have had numerous turning points, but what comes to mind when I first asked you that question?
I did have numerous turning points, more than I can count. Two actually come to mind. I worked for a year in banking, in executive banking, business banking. And they wanted to promote me. They loved me, all of this. And I went, no. And I went and started another company because I couldn't. Again, it was that thing of having to do what somebody else tells me to do when I know it's not the proper course. And I really realized in that time that one of my gifts is being able to see the lay of the land of the economy and markets in general, and a company specifically, and to know the right course of action. And the second one is closing down my tech company this last year.
Okay.
And really realizing that, you know, the VC world can be really wonderful for some companies, and it wasn't for mine, and it wasn't for me and how I do business, and that's okay.
How did you get the courage to close down your company, kind of in today's environment where it's still a little precarious, we're not sure which direction the economy is going? How did you gather that courage to make another pivot?
We ran out of money and I had no choice.
That'll do it.
Does it every time.
Yeah.
No, actually, I wish I would have paid attention to my intuition and my knowing about when it was a right time to close it down, and closed it down 2 or 3 years earlier. But I didn't. And again, that's where this deep feeling of follow your intuition, really know what's right for you and for your life and for your company. And only you can know that. Nobody can tell you that.
True. Now, where you are right now, why do you love what you do currently?
Oh, my goodness. I get to work with remarkable, inspiring women all over the world that are changing the world in large and small ways. And I get to help them to hone their leadership skills, to find these pivot points in their companies, to find weaknesses in their companies, and to really come at business from this deeply creative space of being engaged but not holding tightly.
And when you meet women who maybe are a little bit fearful, scared to step into their potential leadership roles, what advice do you give them?
Well, I have a lot of work that I do with women because we've been told for millennia that we can't hold positions of power, that we can't be in charge of the purse strings, that girls aren't good at math, right? We've been taught for so many years, for thousands of years, that we can't. And now we're starting to realize that we can. And this is a really powerful, pivotal time that we're starting to realize that on a bone deep level, that we can, and we have an equal seat at the table with anybody else. And I just feel honored to be a part of it.
All right. And then on the flip side, what is something that scares you?
It scares me to not have showed up, to not have made a difference, because there's been times in my life that I went through deep depression and I wasn't able to show up and really be present and make a difference. That's probably what scares me most.
When you were experiencing those times of deep depression, how did you pull yourself out of that?
Oh, some days I didn't. Some days I was curled up underneath my blankets crying. I mean, you know, I lost over $1 million in this company and a lot of other people's money too. And it was a pretty horrific experience. But through community, through friends, through my spiritual practices, through just getting up in the morning and going for a run, even when I didn't want to, cooking myself good food. It's basic self-care. And, you know, we've gotten to where we think self-care is this, you know, magical spa day that we do. Self-care is something that is every moment of every day. It's how we talk to ourselves. It's how we feed ourselves. It's how we take care of our bodies and our minds and our spirits and whatever that means for you.
What do you feel are maybe 2 or 3 under the radar ways to practice self-care that aren't talked about a lot?
Ooh, that's a good one. Have fun. Have fun. Do something that makes you feel like you're 5 again. Whether it's picking up crayons and coloring, or going for a walk on the beach, or buying a kite and flying it, or going out with your best friend. One of my favorite things to do when I'm really, really, really angry that's very cathartic is to go out into the woods with a friend, bring a tarp, and buy some really cheap dishes at a thrift store. And of course, you put the tarp down. You don't want to desecrate nature. But you throw those things at the tree and you break them.
Oh,
and each one, you have an intention, right? So that you can break this thing that is holding you back, this piece of anger. Because anger and rage that's another self-care thing. Anger and rage. Women are taught, people are taught to not feel anger and rage. And it is incredibly powerful. And righteous anger and righteous rage will burn up what is no longer needed. Should you stay in it forever? No. But it's really important to be in it and feel it so that you can then move past it. Because if you don't, then it eats you alive from the inside and eats up all of your relationships around you.
True. So it's okay to have a little bit of anger and rage as long as we can get through it.
Yes, and there's tools for that, right? There's therapists. There's friends. There's running. There's the good food. There's all of those things. And there's nature. You know, we live in this wonderful, amazing city of Los Angeles that sometimes nature can be a little bit hard, like true nature can be a little bit hard to get to. But when you're really at that low point, going and sitting beneath a tree and just feeling that the earth is actually there and is supporting you is really powerful. A friend who's a therapist told me the other day, and I've been trying it. I don't know if it's true, but I'm having a feeling like it might be. And they said that if you put your feet on the ground, you spread your toes and you put your feet on the ground, if you're feeling anxious, and really feel your feet on the ground, you can't do that and feel anxious at the same time.
Hmm. Interesting. I like it. I'm going to go try that. Thanks for sharing.
Sure.
Now, your industry, the industry that you're in, is still somewhat crowded.
Yes.
How do you rise above all the noise and distinguish yourself from the competition?
Again, be yourself. You are not going to speak to everyone. You are not going to be everyone's cup of tea. I am not everyone's cup of tea. I'm sure some people can't stand me. That's fine. But the people that I do speak to, that I speak their language and they speak mine, those are my people. Those are my clients. Those are my customers. I don't need to worry about the other ones.
How long did it take for you to find your people, and what are some signals that you were able to receive when you were like, aha, this is one of my tribe, one of my people?
Connecting with people, again, is one of my gifts. And when I started writing my blog, that was kind of my stick my toe in the water to see how people reacted to, because I was already consulting.
Right.
People have come to me for consulting for 25 years. I just didn't make a business out of it until 3 years ago when people started going, hey, maybe I should do this. I was like, oh, gosh, but I really enjoy that. Well, I could make a business out of something I really enjoy. Awesome. And yeah, I just started doing it. And once I started doing that blog, and I would get emails back from people. And it was a very close-knit group of people that I was sending it to, like maybe 300 people at first, right? Yeah. And the feedback that I got was so powerful that it was actually making a difference in people's lives. It was changing the conversation. It was changing the way that they were thinking about critical issues within their lives.
Interesting. All right. Now, how has a failure or an apparent failure set you up for later success? Do you have a favorite failure of yours?
Oh, yes.
Talk to us.
Again, my tech company. It was a glorious, wonderful, massive failure. I was CEO, and again, I was also the main investor. And we had a great product. We had a good team, and I couldn't find funding. Mm. We found small funding.
Right, right.
But, $300,000 or $400,000 does not do it when you're building a tech product and a tech company. We were looking for, $2.5 million just to start with.
Yes.
And I didn't get it. Mm. And I realized too late in the process that the venture capital world was really not my world. I did it because the company we were able to be a part of, one of the premier hardware accelerator programs in San Francisco. So we were there for 6 months. And everybody told me that that's what you do. You go to VCs. And I, for the first time in my business career, really listened to other people and what the general public told me I should do, instead of what I thought I should do. And I put on that mask and I did it, and it was miserable. Mm. And I wish I'd realized, truly realized earlier, alternative funding sources, such as family offices or revenue-based investing, things like that, that can be kind of a different platform for, because it was a company in the clean tech space, so okay. that already narrows it down. Female CEO, and this was, you know, 5 years ago that I was searching for money. Things have changed a lot in 5 years, thankfully. But 5 years ago, I was still walking into boardrooms that were all middle-aged, rich white dudes. With them telling me, oh, you know, I really like this company, but, you know, you're a woman. Yes, I am. And hearing from other women that were told, CEOs, that were told things like, oh, you have young children at home. Shouldn't you be home with your children and have your husband here? Hmm. Like, no, I'm the CEO.
Right, yeah.
It's, and I, again, I'm so grateful things have changed a lot in 5 years, and these are still deep conversations that are just at their beginning, at this precipice of larger conversations.
Yeah. And you said that you would have investigated alternative funding sources.
Yes.
If you could go back to the beginning, anything else you would have done differently?
Yes. I wouldn't have listened to my business partners or some other outside people telling me how to actually spend the funding. I would have held the purse strings tighter.
Understood. Definitely. You've had a lot of success in your career, despite the failure you just shared. You've had multiple successes. You've gotten much mention in the press and the media. Because of that, you do acquire critics, or haters, as we call them. How do you handle your critics?
Sometimes well, sometimes not well. it hurts.
Yes.
It hurts really badly. And that's one of those reasons why during the failure of the company that I did go through days and weeks that I was curled up in my bed and depressed. Because everybody telling you what you're doing wrong and or you can't do it or you shouldn't do it. Or that you're terrible at it is very, very painful. It also builds a resiliency. And even though it's always going, I think it will always hurt. I'm too sensitive and empathic for it not to, yeah. which is also a great benefit, I feel, that I bring to the leadership table. So that will always hurt. But it's a matter of learning the tools to be able to go, oh, I feel that hurt. It's there. Take a breath and move on. Acknowledge it. Really feel into it. And keep on going. Because what I've found, especially these last couple of years, is whenever I do have a critic, whenever I do have a hater, 20 minutes later, I have somebody telling me how much I've helped them. And I would much rather have that be the voice in my head than have the hater be the voice in my head.
True. I like it. Now, you might have already shared, but I still have to ask. But we always ask people to tell us about the darkest time in their life, how they got through that, and what did they learn from that experience. So I'll ask that again. And is there another time that comes to mind, or is it this main situation you've explained previously?
No. Actually, there was a time before that. Too, when I was in my 30s, I lost both my parents. I lost a child. And that's part of the reason I started the business. And unfortunately, I started it without fully healing those losses. And I think that's part of the reason I wasn't really listening to myself and my own intuition and my own knowing. But that was extraordinarily difficult. I'm an only child. And my parents were my best friends. My dad was my business advisor and my financial advisor. And my mom was just Jenny. She was wild and crazy and glorious. And
For someone like you who's lost both their parents and seeing how that can just stop you in your tracks, then to add on losing a child, how were you able to persevere?
Friends, people that love me, people that called and were there and brought soup and sent cards and sent handmade gifts and Because I've lived all over the world, I have community everywhere. And thankfully, we have the technology these days that we can still stay connected. But it is challenging. You know, it's different than being in person with someone. You know, I have so many friends that grew up in a town and still live in a town and have their family there and all of their friends there. And when something goes wrong, everybody comes over. And there's this physical contact and this physical continuity that isn't there, but there's still the love there. And, you know, the fact that I have friends and loved ones literally probably in every time zone that I know are there at the drop of a hat, whether it's on Zoom or, you know, that's my best friend.
It is,
It's really powerful. And also talking about it. You know, I was very young when my parents died. You know, now that I'm in my late 40s, a lot of my friends have a parent or parents that have died.
Right.
When you're 30, nobody else has gone through it. Yeah. And nobody else really knows what that feels like and can relate to it. And so the fact that my friends were able to be there and just sit and listen for the most part, even if they couldn't fully relate. And also I got therapy. I got counseling.
What is your definition of resilience?
I think resilience is a built and a learned capacity. I think it comes from a lifetime of years of failure, of the hard things, of, you know, deeply difficult happenings in life. That's part of what makes us human. That's a huge part of what makes us human. You know, if everything was fabulous every day, it would be really kind of sad and boring. It's these difficulties that allow us to, you know, in the words of Clarissa Pinkola Estes, be part of the scar clan.
Mm.
You know, and these scarrings leave us to be more beautiful on the inside and outside.
I always say the most beautiful people in the world have scars.
Absolutely. Mm.
Who was the most influential person for you growing up?
My parents and, I mean, I know this is not one person, my parents and my grandparents.
Okay.
I was so fortunate. My parents were older when I was born, and they were fabulous. I mean, of course, everybody has things that aren't fabulous, but for the most part, they were pretty amazing. We traveled all over the world together. We had, we had plenty of money, but they didn't overall spend it on frivolous things. They spent it on travel. They spent it on experiences and education, and being with people that we loved. And they were funny and smart and unconditionally loving, which is what I wish for everyone to be able to experience, is to have somebody in their life that unconditionally loves them.
Definitely. What do you find easy to do that your friends find hard to do?
Take chances. Yeah.
Go ahead. If you want to say more, go ahead. Because I got a follow up for you, so go ahead.
To take chances, you know, and I hear that all the time. Oh my gosh, you've started 13 companies? How'd you do that? I don't know. I just put one foot in front of the other and I tried it the other way, working for somebody else, and that was way worse. And I don't see them as chances. I see them as opportunities and opportunities to grow and learn. And of course I'm going to get beaten up and I'm going to get knocked down and things are going to fail and not work. And I'm going to cry myself to sleep because I've had an awful day because, you know, I just got sued by somebody or, you know, life happens. But overall, it's not a risk. It's not a chance. It's an opportunity.
What is one chance you've taken that you're most proud of when you think of all the hundreds of chances you've taken?
Ooh. I guess Goodness. that's a hard one. What I am, the chances I'm most proud of. Honestly, this is going to sound so cheesy. And as far as romantic relationships, I haven't done well. I've been married twice. But that I feel like my heart is still open.
Oh.
And that I'm still willing to love.
With what you've been through, that's pretty astounding, actually, because you've had your fair share of pain. I probably don't even know the half of it, so interesting. Okay. What would you like to be better at?
Letting things go. Well, nothing. Let me see. How do I put this? It's not. I don't hold grudges. That's actually one of my. To my great benefit, I don't hold grudges. My mom did, and I saw that, and I went, "Oh no, 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 no."
Yeah.
But I'm stubborn. And it served me very well. And knowing when to go, okay, I give, I'm done. It's okay. I can give up on this. And also, I tend to be a perfectionist. So, progress, not perfection, tends to be my daily mantra.
I like it. Yes, progress, not perfection. Definitely. When you were 21, where were you living?
When I was 21, I was living in, let me think, Dallas? No, I was living in Amarillo, Texas.
Okay, we're going to go to Amarillo. Talk to 21-year-old Kimberli. Give her advice based on what you know now. What advice would you give your 21-year-old self?
Do things exactly like you did them. Which, I mean, that... You know, I look back on my life, and miraculously, most of it, I've stayed really true to myself. I don't know how. I really don't. But I have. And yeah, to do that again.
And then what is the one life or one lesson in life that took you the longest to learn?
I think it took me the longest to learn, again, that progress, not perfection piece. I'm slightly OCD.
keep going.
And I have much higher standards for myself than I do for anyone else. And especially with the failure of this tech business, learning to let that go.
Yeah.
And to be okay with, okay, it's not perfect. And as I'm putting this new business out there into the world, you know, I'm getting ready to launch an online course around money and the deep emotional and psychological ties, especially women have to money and finance, and also education around money and finance, all in one course. It's been really difficult for me to put it out because I want it to be perfect.
Yes.
And to just do it.
Yeah.
And it's going to grow. It's going to change. Whatever you're going to do is going to grow and change. And so you might as well just put it out there and do it and let it be its own critter.
Yes.
You know, it's going to do its own thing.
I remember hearing someone say that perfection is a myth. What's your response to that?
Oh, I like that. It is. It's a total myth. How can we be perfect? We're imperfect creatures in every way. That's what's beautiful about us. In fact, I have one of my many altars in my house is to imperfection. And there's this book called The Joy of Imperfection. And I have that as the base of the altar with all of these different things that remind me of my imperfections and the places that I've failed and, you know, haven't said things right and haven't done things right. And I've ticked people off and I've, you know, offended people and all of this stuff that I know I beat myself up over. And who cares? There is no perfection. Yeah. And even if we were to attain perfection in a moment, somebody else isn't going to see its perfection. So
yeah,
just let it go.
Let it go. Every great person has a sentence. What is your sentence? For example, my sentence is I love to help people unlock their creativity by teaching them how to DJ. What is your sentence?
I love that.
Thank you.
I connect people to their innate greatness, joy, and creativity.
Love that. What is one new habit that you've added to your daily routine in the past year or so that has been most beneficial?
So I feel like an old lady. I'm usually in bed by like 8 or 8:30 at night, but I take an hour to an hour and a half, and I read and I write.
I like that.
And I've started going through books that are meaningful to me and that have impacted me throughout my life and reading them very slowly as a meditation and then writing on them so that when I go to bed, and I found this to be extremely powerful, especially as I'm doing a lot of writing right now because I'm also writing a book, I end up waking up in the middle of the night or the next morning with just like all of these ideas that have been ruminating through the night that are just fully formed. It's really remarkable.
We love books here on the podcast. We love to read. So that's a perfect segue. If there's one, two, or three books you feel people should stop what they're doing right now and start to read them immediately, what books come to mind?
Oh, gosh, let's see. I'll pick a smattering of them. There's so many.
There are so many.
So many books around my house. First of all, I have so many bookshelves. It's really kind of scary. And whenever I move, people are always like, oh, well, you'll get rid of books. I'm like, no, I won't.
Don't touch my books.
No, I won't. Yes. And all of my tables are all filled with books. And it's a little out of hand. So as far as finance goes, I would say The Soul of Money by Lynn Twist.
Okay.
It's a really profound book. It talks about the regenerative ability of money within our lives. And it can be really powerful and life-changing. Let's see. Another one is, I referenced earlier, Clarissa Pinkola Estes, Women Who Run with the Wolves. If both women and men, if you haven't read that, it speaks to the depth and the different parts of a woman's psyche from a Jungian psychologist in the context of storytelling. And it's beautiful and poignant and not easy to read, but beautiful. Let's see, is there a third one? There's so many. It's hard to pick. How about if I go with two? And I have many Perfect. Book lists on my website.
Awesome. Awesome. While we're here, tell us about the book that you're writing.
The working title is Own It, How to Make $1 Million Doing What You Love Without Burning Out. And it speaks to this, we've built this society of this cult of busy, right? That we all have to be busy. We all have to be going so fast and doing so much that is not necessarily productive. And it's not adding to our enjoyment or our bottom line, which is much less than ideal. And so it's how to not only build your business and have it be financially successful, but to have it be successful in the way that, to me, success really is, which is success in your physical, your financial, your emotional, your mental, and your spiritual life. Because if your business does not meet those success metrics in all of those ways, you aren't really succeeding. I learned that the hard way with this tech company.
Yeah.
You know, when something is breaking you on the inside, it can't be successful. It doesn't matter how much money it's bringing in. There's a reason people like, unfortunately, Kate Spade have committed suicide. These are people that on the outside seem to have everything.
Have it all.
Exactly. But those internal pressures that we put on ourselves and that we allow the external world to put on us are so breaking that we can't really succeed in that environment. So that's what the book is about.
And can you share what can we do to kind of limit that so we can maybe get more enjoyment out of our work and become less burned out?
Absolutely. First of all, set yourself guidelines and parameters and let all the people in your life know about them. So you are available by email. You check email starting at noon, right? That's what I do. My mornings are dedicated to writing and creativity and also some meetings, but they're always in-person, face-to-face meetings in the morning. Except for one. I have a class that I teach, but it's Zoom. It's close enough. Yes. It's people time. So it's either people time or creative time, right? Writing time. And I don't check my emails unless I know there's something that I have to deal with that's critical, which doesn't happen very often. I'd say maybe twice a month. Most of the time, I don't check emails till afternoon. Because that takes me down into a rabbit hole. And even though I think emails are only going to take 20 minutes to check, 2 hours later, I come up from the rabbit hole and all the extra little, you know, side things that those emails took me to. And I realize I'm exhausted. And another thing is to realize to when you plan out your day, there's a tool that I love to use. It's called END. And it's marking which things are energizing, neutral, or diminishing to your energy levels. And recognize we all have different energy level patterns. So I have more energy in the morning. But my ex-husband, he has more energy at 2 a.m., right? Not a good match, but
we learn lessons.
We learn lessons. But we all have different energy patterns, and there's no right or wrong to them. There's only working within them and managing them. So when we can actually look at where our energy is going and what energizes us, what neutralizes us or is neutral to us and what diminishes us, then we can plan out our days in a way that we take advantage of when we have the most energy. So first thing in the morning, I write and I do these things that energize me for a few hours and, you know, meet with people, do this. And then as I'm coming out of that, I realize, okay, I'm on a high right now. I have a lot of energy and I can do things that would normally be really diminishing to me and get some of those things done that I know at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, I'm going to have no energy for whatsoever. Yeah. Yeah. And then I can have lunch and after lunch do more neutral things and maybe towards the end of the day, some more creative things again.
I like it.
But to really find out what that flow is for you, and it takes some playing with. It takes some figuring it out, but you know it when you hit it. Because at the end of the day, you don't feel exhausted. You feel, if not energized, you feel good, you know?
Yeah.
And I think we live in this culture, again, this cult of busy, that we feel like we have to be energized all the time. And that's not healthy either. It's having these places that you can be in contentment and really be okay with where you're at in that moment. And be happy with yourself no matter what it is that you accomplished. That goes a long way. You know, this flagellation of I didn't achieve enough today. I didn't do enough today. Just kills you. Yeah. It kills your mental state. It kills your energy. It kills your ability to get up and do it again the next day.
Yeah. When are you expecting to release this book?
I don't know because
gotta keep writing.
Yeah, I have to keep writing. Yeah. I'm debating if I'm going to go with a traditional publisher or self-publish. There's benefits to both. So if I self-publish, it will probably be middle of the year. And if I go through a publisher, well, that adds a whole nother level of complexity.
Yeah. As someone who's just about to release his first book, I've been there. So yeah. Yeah. Wow. What has been the best advice you have ever received?
You know, I'm not sure it's one thing. Again, I was fortunate enough to grow up in a household that my parents were not only unconditionally loving, but they valued my opinion. Starting from the time I can remember, we had family meetings and they asked my opinion on things that were happening in our lives. They let me design my own spaces in the houses we designed. I was meeting with an architect at 10 years old designing my space. In that, the best advice I ever got was, again, to listen to your own voice, to know that you have a voice and that it is worthy, and that voice is enough and you are enough just as you are.
Got it. Got it. Now, are you a sports fan at all?
No.
It's okay. It's okay. We will adjust. Let's just paint a picture here. Say we're going to Staples Center and they announce that Kimberli is coming to the court.
Mm-hmm.
What's the song that's playing as you walk out to the court, like your walk-up song?
Ooh. Oh, there's so many good ones. Again, music. I've actually DJed in the past too. So
okay. All right. All right.
Oh, gosh. But of course, when somebody asks, you can't think of, like, I can hear it and I can't think of the name. So we'll just say, oh gosh, this is a hard one.
That's why we leave it, save it for last.
Thanks. oh gosh, I know there's a really good one that's just not coming to mind. There's a gazillion really good ones.
Well, who are some of your favorite artists? Let's start there.
Oh gosh, again, so many.
Like a top five. Who's coming to mind right now?
Let's see. ZZ Ward.
Okay.
This is one of my things I'm not good at. When somebody asks me names, my brain goes completely blank unless I've written them down beforehand.
Do you want to sing the song if you can remember the words or the lyrics? Do you want to sing the song?
Oh gosh. you know what? We'll just go with something completely ridiculous and stupid because it's the only thing I can think of right now. This we all have our things we're not good at. This is mine.
What's the song that comes to mind?
We Are the Champions, which is completely
okay.
Only because we used to, when I was a cheerleader, you know, of course, we would come out to that.
Okay, fair enough. See, we got through that. That's good. I've had my shells and kicks in my face, but I've come through. And I need to go home. People, how can they find you? Where do you live on social media, your website, all the information?
So the benefit of having a unique name, it's Kimberli spelled with an I on the end instead of a Y.
Indeed.
Hudson, is that I'm the only one. So if you look up Kimberli Hudson, that's my website, that's my social media handles, everything. Super simple.
Cool. Great. Well, before I ask you the final question, just want to say thank you very much for coming on the podcast, coming down here from Pasadena. I really enjoy your perspective on many things and how you continue to get back up even after you had this really tough kind of transition recently. So keep going. Appreciate that. Thank you for sharing your wisdom and all your expertise with us. And I let our guests take us home with any last minute words or wisdom or advice. So I'll say thank you again and take us home.
Thank you so much, Imani. I appreciate being here. I just encourage everyone to realize every day when you get up, look yourself in the mirror and tell yourself that you love yourself, that you're a rock star, that you are enough, and there is enough everywhere for you because this is a hella abundant universe, and you're a part of it.
Preaching to the choir. Thank you.
Thank you for listening to the Imani Experience podcast. You can check out the show notes on imaniexperience.com/podcast. Please remember to leave us a review on the platform you are listening on and share this podcast with anyone who you feel would benefit from listening. See you soon for our next episode.